Welcome to the latest edition of the SWN Podcast. This is episode 188. My God, season 5. This is presented by Manscaped. I'm your host, as always, Billy. I warn everyone right now, I've been laid up with a cold for the last couple of days, so I sound even worse than usual, but my guest doesn't. My guest at this time, he is the current Target Wrestling High Octane Division Champion, a former Target Wrestling Tag Team Champion, former member of the Spawn of Targets. It's Owen Ozzy Michaels. Welcome to the show.
Thank you very much for having me. How are you doing?
I've been better. I'm actually, this is probably of the last couple of days, this is the one that can actually take heat, which is great. Because I went to go see Ant-Man last night, and I went through to Inverness, and I was shaking the whole time. But I was I've booked my ticket, so I'm going to go see Ant-Man. But I was just like shaking the whole time during it. Person next to me was probably having a whale of a time watching me die in the corner while I was trying to see Quantumania. But no, thank you for coming on. I've had a couple, well, I think the other, I've had Shady Natras, and I've had Fulton King. So I've had a couple of guys from Target, but I want to get more guys from there, because we feature Target Wrestling, because you guys are kind of straddling the border of Carlisle, and then you come up here for Dumfries and what have you. So it's nice to get you guys onto the show whenever we can. And of course, you're a champion, so it always helps that we get one of the champs on.
Exactly. Why wouldn't you want me on?
Exactly. So I've got loads of questions I'm going to ask you, but we'll start with the most classic question when it comes to wrestling podcasts. I know you've done a couple in the past, and the guy NWC show a while ago. But it's a classic. What got you to pro wrestling? So what was the moment watching it that got you hooked on wrestling?
I don't know if there's a specific thing I can point to that got me hooked. Like, my earliest memory of wrestling, and it's a completely random one. It was, well, maybe it's not my earliest, but it's probably the one that I think of like the most, that when I look back, it's the one that I can think of. It's a shite match as well. It's like absolutely hot. Like, you know, Goldberg and Brock from, I think it was WrestleMania 20.
Oh, right. Okay. Yes.
But I would have been like 2 or so at the time. I don't know how old I would have been, but like, I just remember, because at the end, obviously Austin gives Goldberg like the stunner, and I was really confused, because for some reason, like, my 2-year-old brain, I turned to my dad and I was like, oh, why is he like attacking him, because aren't they like a tag team? Because I thought, just because they were both bald, I just associated that they would be like teaming up. But that, yeah, it's a complete random memory, but I've watched wrestling ever since I was, you know, like, I came out the womb pretty much. Like, my dad was a fan. He's not as much of a fan anymore, but it's just something that kind of sticks. Like, I feel like with wrestling, like, you grow up watching it and you kind of either you dip out of it or you just carry on, and I just carried on. So
that's it. I found that, because a lot of people that I speak to, it's usually men that I speak to about wrestling. This is the sweat in my glasses. I can just see it. This is illness, folks. mostly folk, it is exactly that. If you speak about wrestling, they always go, oh, I used to watch that when I was younger. Or it's, have you seen whatever is going on nowadays? You've made me feel old straight away when you said you were 2 at WrestleMania 20, because I think I would have been 13 going on 14 when that happened. God. It was 2004, I think, was WrestleMania 20. So that's a great start. That's such a random one. Think Goldberg and Austin were a team, but then when you go back,
Random. I think it's just the shiny heads that I was like, oh, they must be in cahoots or something. But no, he gave him a stunner, and that's one of my earliest memories. So yeah,
that's one of those weird things, though, when you go back and look at the history, and Goldberg and Austin were always on opposite sides of things, WWF, WCW years. Like, that's just like how your brain put them together, because they're 2 bald guys.
Yeah, yeah.
And then, I think next year on SmackDown there was the Jiminy, and there were 2 bald guys that looked the same as well. So it was a very, very weird. But no, it's like, so two till now. So what's that? About 20 years you've been watching wrestling.
Yeah.
Okay, that's cool. I can ask things about that. That's no bother, because I'm old and I was well watching wrestling by then. Do you have any favorites straight away, or was there anyone that? WrestleMania 20 was a really great show in general.
Well, Rey Mysterio's always been my favorite. He was just the guy. Like, it was he was always like the main one for me. I've liked Eddie Guerrero as well, obviously. Who doesn't? Booker T. Loved Booker T. I actually do like a lot of, well, I say a lot of his moves, but I do quite a few of his moves in like my own moveset as well. He's influenced us quite a lot. Shawn, of course, Shawn Michaels. Yeah, just like kind of like, I don't want to say the obvious ones, but you know, the kind of the, a lot of the ones that a lot of the people that are wrestling now kind of looked up to, if you get what I mean. I feel like there's a list of guys that it's like a lot of us kind of look to and kind of influenced from, if you get what I mean. So yeah, those are the ones that were my favorites, I would say.
Yeah, so back to that card. What's the rest of 20? Of course, Shaw was at the main event, the triple threat against Triple H and Stevie Richards. And yeah, of course. So 20. So you're speaking of Rey Mysterio. That was the cruiserweight open, wasn't it? That it had the big cruiserweight match. It had Ultimo Dragon falling over twice before you even got
yes,
to the ring.
Yeah, because I think you have. That was it. Yes.
This podcast won't all be about WrestleMania 20. It's a great WrestleMania. So it's just, I've just got loads of memories from it. Anyway, we'll move on that from there. So Mysterio, Booker T, that's like quite a contrast between styles there. So you said you never stopped watching wrestling. So wrestling was always part of your way. Were you I don't want to use the word backyarder, but were you ignoring the warnings to not wrestle at home or in school?
Yeah. I feel like everyone who's grew up watching wrestling's tried it at home once or twice. I was always, I'd always go over to my cousins like on the weekend, and we'd just fucking wrestle on the trampoline and throw each other off it and stuff. Yeah, I was well into that. Yeah,
you always like to use it as a loophole. Go, well, I'm not wrestling at my home. So
yeah, exactly. It's not my like. It's not my school. It's not my home. It's someone else's. So you know,
exactly. They're the wrong. But did you have your own character, or were you always someone else? Were you always like another?
Oh no, I was just getting my shit in. I was just getting all the moves in, all the cool stuff, RKOs and all that stuff. No character until I started training.
So we'll fast forward a good bit then. So when did you go into any local shows before you started training, or how did you get into this local scene?
No, so that's a bit like it was around the time I was in sixth form, and I was like, it's kind of the thing of like, what am I going to do when I leave school type thing. And I was like, fuck it. Well, I really want to give wrestling a try. I've always wanted to. I just never, it's like, I saw myself doing it. I just didn't really know if I actually, I don't know. It was kind of like thinking, will I or will I not? And I was like, well, I may as well. It's like, there's no point not trying. Like, I could have went for one session. I was like, well, it's not for me. At least I've gave it a go. But yeah, so I was like searching online, because obviously Target Wrestling's in Carlisle, and that's where I grew up. Like, I've born and bred in Carlisle, but I never actually knew Target Wrestling was in Carlisle until I searched it up. Like, I didn't really I never went to any of the shows or anything, but I was like, well, I want to give it a go. I'm going to see what's the closest. I was expecting somewhere like Newcastle or Glasgow would probably be like the closest schools to me, but then it turns out that there's an actual wrestling school in my hometown. I was like, yeah, fuck so. Like, you know, I'll just give it a go. So I messaged Ryan Devlin, and he was like, yeah, just come down to a session. And I was like, yeah, fuck it. I guess I'm doing it. So got my knee pads, got my boots, and I went and gave it a shot, and here I am.
So when that first training session happened, did you have in your mind, did you think, right, we're going to go in, I'm going to do some entrances, we'll do that first, and then a couple promos, and then RKOs. Job done.
Yeah, I've got yeah. It was weird. I especially remember, like, I remember going in, and I was like, damn, I'm actually stood in a wrestling ring for the first time, like, an actual, you know, something that's not a trampoline and stuff. And I was like, oh god, this is mad. Like, yeah, I didn't know what actually to expect when I first went. Like, I kind of knew that they'd put you through like the obvious, like, you know, like the bumps and all that, but I wasn't too sure, like, fully what to expect. So I think you go in and you learn all the obvious, like, you know, your chain and stuff and your first bumps and all that. I think it was Damon Havoc took me outside, and he was showing me like all the transitions and all that. But yeah, like I enjoyed it a lot more than I thought I actually would. But yeah, it's something that I'm glad I did it. You know what I mean? Well, obviously I am, because I've stuck with it for 4 years now, I think. So yeah, it was fun. Yeah.
So you started then, what, 2018, 2019 is when you started training. So yeah. probably that were the big boom of indie wrestling was kind of been and gone by that point, because it was right about 2016 or so. So you said you thought maybe Newcastle or Glasgow school would be, were you aware of the British scene at all, like ICW or anything like that?
Yeah, like there you go. I knew like of the ICWs and stuff like that. I didn't like I said, because I didn't know that Target existed. I wasn't too sure on like the smaller promotions and stuff or whereabouts they'd be based. So like you said, like I said, I was thinking, oh, I'm gonna have to trek to Newcastle. Like, well, I say trek to Newcastle, it's only like an hour or so. But I was thinking, oh, I'm gonna have to go away and find somewhere. But I was quite lucky that Target was there. But yeah, when it comes to my knowledge on like the actual British scene at the time, like you know of like all the wrestlers and stuff that like, come from the UK and all that, but I didn't fully know what the actual scene was like until I actually got fully interested in myself, and then I started doing like my own research and stuff and like finding out who wears what and stuff like that.
And we're quite at a good age as well, where there's so much information at your fingertips through YouTube and through nerds like myself having a big website about everything going on in a particular country. So you can find just about anything you need to know. As far as so you started training, you did Damon Havoc, who is vastly underrated in my opinion. But every time I watch a Target show, Damon Havoc is always one guy I'm like, I really enjoyed watching David Havoc's match, because you know what you're gonna get with David Havoc, and it's just, yeah, he's really great. So you didn't know who David Havoc then was, so you weren't aware of what he could do. He was just a guy showing you how to do lockups. Was it who's your initial trainers, or was there anyone that you walked in and saw and went, oh God, he's a wrestler, he's quite scary looking? Was there anyone in your first couple
So,
sessions?
the main train obviously was Medallion, aka John Latra. So I don't know if I should blur the lines or what with who's actually Medallion, but he's the person that I would say is the reason I've got to where I am now. He's the main trainer of Target. Obviously, there was Shady Natras as well, who like Shady used to do the he would do the odd session as well, but he kind of like stopped a bit just kind of as I was starting. I got a few sessions in with him, and he's taught us a fair bit as well. As I was coming in, he kind of stopped not long after. Damon Havoc, obviously, he's taught me a lot as well. But yeah, I'd say those are the two main dudes I would say that helped me in Target for when I was first starting was Medallion and Damon Havoc. So, but like you said, it's changed a lot now. Obviously, when I first started there, there was a bunch of people. Oh, who was it? There was Tommy Oliver. He was there. Coyote Kid, was it? I
I
think
remember
Coyote
the
Kid.
name Coyote Kid from results,
Yeah,
yeah.
he's gone now. But he was there. Ben Vicious was there, if you remember that name.
God, yeah, I now realize that when I'm doing Target results, there's a lot of guys pre-COVID that disappeared. Just right, barely.
Carnage was another
Yeah.
one. Carnage me a fair bit as well. Can't forget Carnage. Obviously the likes of Sammy Sparks and that was there as well. But I'd say pre-COVID and post-COVID, the scene of Target's changed quite a fair bit. There's a lot of the older ones have went away, and it's like you've got the newer ones like the Fulton King, Golden Boy Charlie Anderson as well. You're getting the likes of like Logan Reed and all that coming in as well. Yeah, it's changed a fair bit since I started.
Yeah, that didn't even realize that until you were going through the names. And yeah, that's a lot has changed. I mean, I only really started watching Target shows last year, just because it was one of those things where I was wanting to get content on site. It was like there's not much happening, so I was like, I'll watch some Target. Target's got full shows on YouTube, and guys like yourself, Damon Havoc as well, like I've mentioned, and Fulton King. They were the guys I was just like, right, I'll keep an eye on these fellas, because I'm enjoying what I'm seeing here. And of course, the spot of Target being one of the main through lines during that period. We'll go to your debut though. So I think I've got it 2019. I think I wrote it down somewhere. Oh yeah, I've written down 2019 debut. Put who year again, just because that would have been way too much research and effort on my part. So how long was it from you starting training to actually finding out you were going to make your debut?
When did, so I'm trying to picture like the months and stuff. I think it was the end of 2018 where I started. So obviously Target doesn't tend to do like many shows at the end of the year. I think we usually skip December. You know, it's quite a busy period for everyone, Christmas and all that. So we don't usually do a show in December. So I think I started training October 2018, and I think my first show, official first show, was in Morecambe in January 2019. That was a 6-man Target. And for me personally, like I don't know, I don't know if it sounds big-headed to say like I picked it up quite fast, but I felt it felt kind of natural when I first started training. Like I was getting it kind of just like that. It was pretty, I don't want to say easy to make it sound like it's easy because it isn't, but like I was picking up a lot of the stuff quite fast, so I was building, you know, a lot of confidence and stuff. And I was told that I was going to make my debut. I was like, oh God, first wrestling match, here we go. And I loved it. It was sick. I can't remember fully who was in the 6-man tag, but they got me through it pretty w easy. And then from then on, it was kind of like I got through my first match, and then they're like, all right, let's go. And I was like, yeah, let's do it. Let's just keep going. And I've got to where I am pretty, like, that's because I look back as well, and I feel like obviously I've been training like say 4 or so years now, but you take away the time from COVID as well, say like a year or a year and a half or so, I haven't really been doing it too long really. I think I've only had about 52 matches or so. I keep note because I'm a loser, but yeah, so I haven't really been doing it that long really. So I feel like I've made, like personally, I feel like I've done quite well for how long I've been doing it, and I'm just looking forward to seeing how far I can get with it really.
That's it. I mean, I think it was Chris Jericho that said to always keep note of your matches. So, I mean, if Jericho, I mean, there's right and wrong things that Jericho has said and done in the past, but I think that's pretty good. That's a pretty good one to do is keep note. Even if it's for your own part, I mean, you can go through names. We can see, I don't know, you'll see, I've got your first match here. It was Ben Vicious and Havoc Enterprises against Danny Jukes, Owen Michaels, and Sammy Sparks
There
in
we go.
Morecambe. So, I mean, you can look at go, we'll take Tommy Oliver. You could make it to WWE, and you could go, well, I remember when I faced him back in 2019. There you go. That's a. Although every time I see Tommy Oliver's name, I just think of the Green Power Ranger. So that's. I don't know if that was a conscious choice by him there, but when I saw him wrestle for the first time when he came out in blue trunks, I was like, oh, no, that's not what I was expecting at all when I saw him. So yeah, first, did you have any background? You said you picked up quite easily. Did you have any a sport background at all, or anything like dance or anything like that? It's like rhythm kind of thing.
No, so like I never had like a sport in particular that I was like that I did. I was quite sporty in school. I loved PE. PE was like my favorite subject. And to be fair, I always saw myself as being like a PE teacher as like a career. So I don't know if just being sporty in general has helped me like pick it up quite well. But yeah, I'd say like I don't know, like it did just it just felt natural picking it up easy, and I'm not sure exactly why. Like, but I feel like everyone's different with it, because there's other people I've seen that just they pick it up very easily, and then you get some who it takes just a little bit longer for them to kind of just grasp what you're kind of asking them to do. But yeah, for me, I never really had that much of an issue. Like, I'd get shown it quickly, like a demonstration. I'd do it, and then I'd be like, oh, you've got it, and I'm like, yay, good, there we go. So.
You often find that also that you can pick it up and do great in training, but as soon as you actually have a crowd in front of you watching it, it will just all fall
Oh,
apart. So,
yes.
with all that confidence that you'd built up, and that was did it make wrestling in front of actual paying audience people, did that make it quite easy for you, or did you kind of block them out? How was your kind of time in
Oh,
front of an audience?
see, looking back, like it's like I still get nervous now. I don't feel like I feel like if you fully care about how you want your match to go, you'll always be nervous, I feel. Just because you want it to go well, and obviously it's in front of like it could be in front of like 12 people or 200, but I feel like I'll always probably be nervous going out for a match, no matter how. Like I feel like even in 10 years' time, I'll still be nervous, and it doesn't matter who it's against. I feel like it's just I don't know if it's a pressure I put on myself, or it's just the weirdness of play fighting in front of people in spandex. I don't know, but it's just some, yeah, I feel like even though I built up the confidence of you know, doing it all right in training and stuff. I don't feel like it. It obviously it did help in my matches, obviously, but no, I don't think it affected how anxious I got, because that's just it's a different level when you go from, say, training matches to actually doing it in front of an audience. Like there's it's a big difference, I would say.
One of those things, like you said, it is wrestling in spandex in front of an audience. So it could be a case you could go out, and generally it's going to be all people there, kids and families that are there to see some wrestling. But there's always the absolute worst case scenario, and I don't know if I'm going to put fear into any wrestler when I say this, but you can walk out and it's going to be like four lads that have came from the pub and are just going to heckle you for 20 minutes instead. And it could happen. Hopefully it never does, but. And then you're sitting there, you stand there feeling silly because you're there in your spandex and you're just getting heckled soundly instead of having people cheer or boo you instead. So I apologize to anyone who's listened to that and went, oh God, that's now my nightmare forever. So sorry about that. Right, okay. So you said, yeah, kind of that weird thing after the pandemic, you don't know whether to count that as a year of your training or not. How did you kind of cope during that? Because you started training 2018, 2019, first full year, and then 2020 started and it kind of ended, and that was it in March.
Yeah, it's firstly, I was so like everyone, I was so bored. Like, and it's weird going from like doing shows and stuff and training to just dead nothing, and you just sat at home. Like, because obviously at the time you look back and we didn't know how long it was going to be. Like, you remember it happening and you've seen it on the news. Oh, we're going into lockdown. I'm like, oh, well, this might last a week. And then it ends lasting like a year or whatever it did. And you're like, oh, God. But it was boring, but also very, very, very frustrating, because I felt like I was getting to a good point and I felt like everything was clicking pretty well. I was fortunate enough to be getting some big matches and stuff. And then obviously COVID hits and it just takes the legs from underneath it and everything's just stopped. And then, like, I didn't know how much it would affect me when I got back, because I was worried that, like, oh, I've built up all this like knowledge and stuff of like through my training and that, and I was like, oh, am I just gonna forget it all, and am I gonna have to start at square one again? But it was kind of like riding a bike when you get back. Like, I surprisingly didn't lose as much as I did. It was just really the frustrating thing of like having to stop, and then you feel like, because it was weird, because I started this like gimmick as well. I had like the I think that there's a few matches on YouTube. I come out with like a mirror. I was the whole like pretty boy thing, and I was like, oh, this is quite a good gimmick, this. And then obviously COVID happens, and then that's just scrapped, and I'm like, oh well. But yeah, it was more just the frustrating part of having to stop, really, and not knowing what to do with yourself. Like, really, like, yeah, that was the main frustration with it, really.
How did you kind of keep? Because I know for myself, I did stupid Twitter polls and I did this. This is what I started doing during lockdown. I don't know if you went through the bread making phase, the Twitch phase, but how did you kind of keep yourself? I don't know, mentally occupied in terms of your wrestling training. Was there online classes that you kept an eye on? Was there just watching matches that you wanted to pick up some bits, or were
Yeah,
you just trying to
that
keep
was it,
yourself in?
really. That was it, because it's like, obviously you can still technically quote unquote kind of train with it. You can still like try and gain as much knowledge in that as well, but it's like the main thing that COVID took away was that physicality of it, and like the physical aspect of training. Like, say if I saw like a cool move or something and I'm like, oh, I'm gonna do this, I can't do it. I guess I could find a teddy bear or something and practice or whatever, but like it's not the same, is it? So it's like, yeah, that's the main thing COVID took away, was the physicality of like actually being able to just grab someone and knowing like the actual mechanics of a move and stuff. But like keeping myself occupied during COVID, it was like you said, just watching a lot of matches, trying to pick up as much as I could just from like the visual aspect of it. But yeah, it was hard. It was, like I said, it was boring. And like, I feel like it's, as much as I love wrestling as well, there's only so much you can watch before you maybe like burn yourself out of it, if you get what I mean. Because the frustration, like, it's just like anything, really. Like I said, I'm a very sporty person. I much prefer doing the sport than watching it, if that makes sense. Like, the frustrating thing about watching the wrestling was I couldn't do it. And like that made us kind of like not, I wouldn't say bitter, but it was frustrating. Just like, oh, okay, I'll watch this match, I'll watch this match, I'll watch this match. And there's so much wrestling. I could be watching wrestling for years and like find new stuff every day, but there's just a different aspect to actually doing it yourself, like that I can't really explain, but you get what I mean.
Oh yeah, absolutely. Because I mean, what well, there's at least one, at least 2 hour wrestling show on each day if you wanted to watch and keep current up to date. But I know for myself, I mean, I spend most of my time updating the website and finding results and do that stuff. By the time it gets to the weekend, I'm like, oh, can't be arsed wrestling a little bit. I'm just gonna get a little break. I've spent all week reporting on it, and that I'll watch Elimination Chamber. I'll watch the pay per view instead of the pay per view because I know it's a nice, easy watch. I don't have to think too hard on it. I watched Elimination Chamber this morning, and it was just it's fantastic. But that's about enough for me now. It's I'll watch if a company uploads their show, I'll get to it, but I don't prioritize it anymore because there's so many other things going on, and it's just like I've got to find time. But it's a weird thing. But yeah, like I say, you could watch wrestling forevermore and find new things every day, but yeah, you don't have too much of a good thing. You get scattered a bit.
Exactly, yeah.
So that was it. The wrestling was over, and Target returned eventually in August 2021. There's a big weekender, and then Spawn of Target arrived.
There we
So
are. Yeah.
the pretty boy persona was gone. You were
It
now
was.
Owen Ozzy Michaels. I don't know
Oh,
if
and Ozzy
they're.
Michaels, yeah.
What was the reason behind the Aussie bit? Is it always Owen Ozzy Michaels, or is it Ozzy Michaels? Is it Owen Michaels with Ozzy in quotations?
So whatever you want it to be, really. But it's like so I st well there you go. It goes back to like kind of like my debut. So I had absolutely no idea what I wanted to name myself. That's Ryan. I have Ryan Devlin to thank for that. So I was about to go out for my match, and I'm like, I still don't have a name. And they're like, oh, just think of something. And I'm like, because in my mind, like obviously you can change your name whenever you want, really. Like I could change my name my next match. I'm now Zachary Thompson. Doesn't make any sense, but you know, it's just a random name. But I was like, but this is going to be my name forever, and I'm not able to. Just for some reason, that was in my mind. I'm like, this is the name that's going to be me forever, and blah blah blah. But so he was like, all right, don't worry about it. So he wrote something down, and he was showing everyone. He didn't show me though. I was like, oh shit, what's this? What's this going to be? And then he's like, oh no, don't worry, you'll hear it when I announce it. And I'm like, oh fuck, oh no, I don't know if I'd like this. And then I'll go out, make my entrance. He's like, Owen Michaels. I'm like, oh, well, you know what? Whatever. That's fair enough. I'll take it. It could have been a lot worse. Like Bastion Booger or whatever, you know. But yeah, it's like I was like, you know what? Hey, it's summer. I'll ride with it for a bit. And then because I used to get called Ozzy as my nickname in school. And I'm like, ah, maybe I'll add a bit of pizzazz to my name. A bit of like I don't really know what word I'm looking for, but like I don't even want the edginess,
Pizzazz,
but
a little pizzazz, flair, a little bit of flair there.
Because I feel like Owen Michaels is like, yeah, Owen Michaels is all right, but if I get that Aussie part in the middle, I'm like, you know what, that's it's something a tiny bit different than what I was doing. So I thought, screw it, I'll add Aussie to it and see how it goes. And it's stuck. I feel like it's gives a little bit of extra, you know, like you said, pizzazz. So but yeah, with the name itself, like I don't mind what I'm called. You can call me Owen Michaels, you can call me Ozzy Michaels, or just Ozzy, or it's up to the person, really.
I don't know if this leads on to Amelia Hughes' question that she put through on Twitter,
Oh.
which was, have you learned to spell your name yet?
Right, okay. So the story there is, right, I'll say it because I need new tights anyway. But you still there? Sorry.
I'm still here, yep.
Ah, there we go. Sorry, my phone went weird. So it, I got new tights, obviously after COVID. I was like, oh, look at me, proper. So, because I was just wearing like black like tights that I got because I didn't know what I wanted my gimmick to be or anything. So I was like, screw it, I'll just get black tights. COVID hits, I'm like, all right, coming back, Owen Ozzy Michaels, I'll get some new gear, look like a proper wrestler, jobs are good. And get new tights. I've wrestled for months, by the way, with these tights. No one said a thing. No one said a thing to me. And then I get a message. She wasn't my girlfriend at the time, but she is now. she's like, oh, at least I can spell my name right. And I'm like, what are you on about? And she's like, well, look at your tights. And this shows how much of a perv she is because she was looking at my ass at the time because that's where my name is on the tights. so it's not my fault she's a pervert. But she's like, "Oh, well, Michaels is spelt wrong," and I'm like, "Excuse me, what?" And then I look, and it is. I didn't know this. I did not know. I've been wrestling for months with my name spelt wrong on my ass. But luckily, she was the only one that noticed. But I say to everyone, and they're like, "Oh God," I'm like, "Ah, oh, so." But I'm still wrestling in them. I'll get new tights eventually, obviously. I just like the design at the moment. But yeah, so that's the story with that. But yes, I know how to spell my name correctly, obviously.
It's
But
I mean it's not as bad as Chris Kendall, who I don't know, there's some miscommunication between him and Target, because they often there's, I don't know
oh
if it's one L
yes,
or
I know.
two
I
L's,
think
and when I have to do the
Sammy
result.
Sparks is another victim of this as well. I feel like it's sometimes it's with the X, or sometimes it's like how else do you spell it? It's like Sparks. He's a victim of that
I know, oh, the Chris Kendall one, because every time I look at the results and copy and paste them and then edit what I need to, I look at it and go, that's not right. That's not right at all. I have to go to Chris
too.
Kendall's Twitter and go, no, it is two L's, or one, I don't know what it is, one L. And I'm like, no, go back and change it. And, oh, it's just, yeah, I mean, wrestlers, can you, Michaels is a terrible one as well, but first, that kind of thing, like your spelling thing, because there's people that spell it A-E-L, and there's people that spell it E-A-L. They're like, we all just decide on
I
one.
think people think it just looks more natural with the E and the A that way rather than the AE, but it is what it is. I'm not gonna lose sleep over it anymore. I was stressed when I found out. I was like, "Oh my God, how have I not noticed this?" Because I checked as well. Like, I got the tights. I was like, "Yeah, this all looks fine. This all looks perfect." I remember like sending the design to the gear maker as well, and I was like, "Yeah, that's fine. Spot on. Nothing wrong with that." And then obviously months later, spelt wrong, and I look like a div, but oh well.
I just got really paranoid there. I was checking the thumbnail that I put out just to make sure that I'd spell it the right way. I was like, definitely, yeah, it's okay. It looks right. I'm assuming it is. Yeah, so that's fine. Yeah, so when it came to, so Spotted Target, that's where we're at. Spotted Target.
Yes.
Because Fulton King, Madman Matthews, Chris Kendall as well.
Yes.
Am I missing anyone? It was 4 years. Was it five?
Me, Fulton King, Madman Matthews, Chris Kendall, and then Buddy Roller joins later on.
Buddy Roller, that was it. Sorry, buddy.
Yes.
So Spotted Target. So when you're approached with this idea of the big bad faction, you won the
Yes.
tag titles in September as well, for your first title as well. So when you're approached with the Spotted Target, were you just like, yeah, let me at it.
Yeah, that's a bit so like oh, right, because at first, like I'll say this now, I never used to like tag wrestling. I was always like, I'm a singles dude. Should like focuses on me. I don't need tag partner. Blah blah blah. I've never really been someone that's like, oh, I love tag. Like some people absolutely adore tag wrestling, and I can see where they come from because it is probably one of the most creative match types you can have. And it's the spawn of Target actually helped me appreciate tag wrestling a lot more. But at the time, I was like, I don't know. But like now, I look back on it, it's the best thing that happened to me. Like. But we were approached with the idea and like, oh, you're gonna be this. I'm trying to think of a good group to kind of associate it with or like kind of say it. So I don't know if I'd say Nexus. Like we weren't really essentially like going in and like ripping up the ring or anything, but we were going in attacking people, kind of proving our point that we were like because we were all like Target trainees originally and stuff. So we're like, oh, you're getting all these outsiders in, it should be on us and stuff. So the idea itself, I thought it was sound, and we went with it. I think it was the weekend of show that you mentioned. We attacked Sammy Sparks and Soldato after their match, ran in, did them in and stuff. We proved a point, and we just ran with that. And obviously, we won the tag titles in September against Medallion and Ivy Mist. And yeah, we ran with it, and it was really fun. Honestly, it's probably one of the funnest things I've done so far, I would say.
But it was a really good through story, because that's when I started kind of watching Target a bit more, because seeing this kind of Spotted Target run, moving on to like Isoldato and Sammy Sparks, and then I think that by the time I finished watching what I was watching, it was Tim Strange and Asylum were the tag champions at that point, and you were doing your thing in the high Octane division, but no, it was. When it came to tag team, say it wasn't something you were really into at the time, but when you found out you're going to be in that kind of faction, was there any tag teams that you were like, right, I'm going to go check out some of this stuff, maybe pick and choose some bits and pieces from them at all? Was there any tag teams that you watched to get ideas and inspiration?
That's it. Honestly, I can't speak for the others. Me personally, no, because like I said, it kind of took me. At the time, I was kind of like, "Oh, I don't me and tag stuff. I'm not the biggest thing into it." So obviously, I built over time, and I started kind of thinking of ideas of what to do. And because obviously, with the spawn as well, it was the whole Freebird thing. So the tag partner would change each time. So I could have been tagging with Buddy Roller 1 week. Next week, I could have been tagging with Fulton King, for example. That sets a different dynamic of the sort of stuff you can kind of do in your match, or the sort of, like, say, tag moves and stuff, or like sequences and that. So, yeah, it was a really it was fun in that aspect of how creative you could be with it. Me and Buddy had our own little sequences and stuff. So did me and Fulton. But me personally, I never personally looked. Maybe this makes me look lazy, actually. I maybe shouldn't say it. But I never personally looked for much inspiration. I kind of like thinking of my own stuff, if you get what I mean. Like, probably it's probably not original, because there's probably someone doing it anyway. But if the stuff, like, it's kind of putting stuff that I already do together with someone else. Like, for example, like Buddy Roller. Like, mixing and matching stuff that we do and just making it our own, if you get what I mean.
Yeah. It's also kind of like... I don't know if your mindset was like this, but Spawn a Target was individuals coming together, not a group. You weren't a tag team. You were always a tag team. It was just a group of individuals that came together under one cause. So why would you have many tag moves? Because you weren't a tag team. So that could be a reasoning from now on. We can cut. Mm-hmm. Cut the bit where you may have thought you were lazy, but yeah, so it makes sense that way, because you're a dirty group, so you were like, what, you'd scrap, you would drag people out,
yeah,
pack
yeah,
them
yeah.
And all that kind of stuff, so you wouldn't want to do anything too flashy, because that's not the point of the spot of target. Which, I mean, I was sold on the actual, just the t-shirts as well. I loved that the target logo was like it was
the melting green, like slime.
Amazing. It's like, whoever thought of that was like brilliant. I'm all in on Spawn Target just because of that. I'm very easy pleased as a wrestling fan when it comes to, if you give me something fancy and shiny, nice logo, I'm sold into it already. So yeah, one tag title September 2021. Don't know how much you find, I don't know, belt special, but I suppose tag team belt is a little bit lower in your kind of priority list, because you're a tag team guy. But what was it like winning the title for the first time in wrestling?
So it was a nice feeling, because I feel like, obviously, it's something that everyone kind of, it depends, like, people view them differently. Some people just view them as like a prop, or some people view them as like a big, like, badge of honor. I'd say I'm kind of in the, like, I'm not, me personally, like, I'm not, I would never be upset if I didn't have a belt.
Right.
Because I feel like, as long as you're doing something noteworthy, it shouldn't necessarily matter as much. But also, it is a nice kind of stamp of approval, because if, say, the booker's like, oh, well, okay, we're going to make you a champ, it kind of shows that you're doing something right. Because if you weren't doing it right, then they wouldn't give you that. Because I feel it is, if, especially, like, say, like, obviously, I'm quite proud to have the high octane belt at the moment, because it's like, oh, people view me as someone that can kind of carry this division at the moment. Like, I can have people come in each week and wrestle them, and they're kind of like, people expect that sort of thing of me now, which is a good, it kind of makes me feel good, because it does make me feel like I'm doing something right. And with the tag belt, it's still the same. It's like, being tag champ, you have that responsibility now of, okay, you're the best in that division for that company, and now you're going to have to prove why, like, you have those belts as well. Like, it's not just, oh, you're just giving them, and just, you know. I feel a lot of people, I feel like, they're made champion, and then they're like, oh, okay, that's the box ticked now, I've got that, and then they kind of become complacent. Each to their own, but personally, surely it should make you want it more, because you don't want people to feel, like, regret giving you something, especially when they trust you with it. So that's just me, though. Like, but being a champion, it's like, okay, well, there you go. So I've been tag champ. I've been high octane champ. Surely my next goal is the heavyweight title.
Yeah,
become a triple champ. there isn't many of those in Target. So it's a good goal, isn't it, surely? And then it just makes you work harder. So
that's so it's how one I of those it. Things. One of those things where you wouldn't wear it out. You wouldn't wear the belt out. You'd,
oh,
have,
no.
it, you'd have it in your living
oh,
room.
Oh, no, I know some people that probably would. I know some that would. But
oh, God. I still remember just as a far older than I should have been, but going to shows with a belt, and it's the saddest thing that I can think of. And I mean, that's where they'll stay now for as long as they can possibly be, because I feel like now that I think someone suggested on Twitter, some sort of account said that if you wear a belt, if you're a fan and wear a belt to a show, you should
have to defend it.
Exactly.
Yes.
And from that point
yes,
onwards, I'm like, I am not taking a belt to a show, because someone will call you on it. And like, I took one to a Halloween show. Halloween shows are the only time you get away with it.
Yes.
Without
yes, of
looking
course.
Weird. Or if you're under the age of 15.
It's just a hassle as well. You see people at like WWE pay-per-view, they're carrying around like 3 belts. I'm like, could you be asked carrying around that for the whole day?
I know,
you've got one around your waist and then 2 on your shoulder and stuff. Like, that just seems a hassle, surely.
If you go to a pay-per-view, you've got a chair to take home as well. Where are you going to put the
exactly.
chair?
Exactly. Yeah. Hey, each the run.
I know. It's fine if I'm driving to a show, because I can just put the belt back into a back seat and that's it. But I went to shows in Elgin and I had to walk home. It was like walking home with the belt around my waist. I had my hoodie over the top of it. I thought, because there's some drunk that's going to try and mug me. And I can't go to the police. What are they to steal? Well, it's still my WWF European Championship. I'm like, I'm building like a dick either way here. This is just awful. So belts are cool. That's pretty much it. That's what we can surmise from there. But no, you had a couple of cool matches that was seen in 2022. Mm-hmm. So, of course, the breakup of the spot of Target happened. You guys had an absolute amazing match. It was yourself and Chris Kendall against Fulton King and...
me and Buddy Brawler versus Chris Kendall and Chris.
Yeah,
Chris Kendall and Chris. We're both getting mixed up.
Fulton
Chris
King
Kendall
and Fulton Chris Kendall.
Sorry, there we go.
If I mind right, you had a very awful spill right near the start of it, start of the match. Well, I don't know how much it might just be the camera work, because the camera was focused down the entranceway while there was a brawl happening, and then suddenly you kind of appeared and then disappeared as quickly as possible on the left hand side.
Yeah. Trust me, the camera work actually makes it look a lot better than it was.
So is it just the dive went wrong, or
just the timing thing, I would say. I was like, so they're out, and I'm like, okay, screw this. Well, you're beating up my dude, I'm gonna dive on you. maybe I went a bit too early, or maybe they were a bit further out than I was expecting. Luckily the cameraman saves us a bit there. But yeah, land right on my dome, and I was I was shocked that I was completely fine. But I land right on my head. I'm like, oh, this is lovely. Crowd's reaction tells the story as well. There's like, I don't know if you can hear it much in the YouTube video, but I've seen like phone footage of it, and the crowd just like, oh my god, he's dead. And I'm like, oh, I'm okay. Chris throws me back in and we continue with the match. Like, luckily the rest of the match was pretty solid, but it could have been a bit messy at the start.
It was absolute chaos, which is what I'd expect anyway if it was like a faction breaking up. But so when Spawn broke up, do you think that was it was time kind of thing, or are we quite happy for it to move on, or do you think it might be premature? How did you find Spawn in general?
See, I loved working with Spawn. I feel like we could have done a lot more with it, but also we were the tag champs, so we've already done that. It just really depends on how much you want to ride it until then people kind of get bored of it. Mm-hmm. Because if we just do the same thing every week and then it's like, oh, we're Spawn, another match done, depending on like... There is a lot of different stories we could tell, but I feel like that's just wrestling in general. Like, there's so many things you can do, or like different avenues you can take. I don't think it was necessarily too premature. Like, well, for me personally, it benefited me a lot going into my singles run. But I wouldn't have minded if we continued for a little bit. But also, I feel like we ended with quite a big, like a good match. So I feel like it worked out pretty well personally.
Yeah, so ended on top. It didn't want to.
Yeah,
because I mean, there's only so many times you can attack someone and put them through a table before folks.
Yeah, of course. Like, I feel like, especially with Spawn, like the whole point was like we were the trainees that were like disgruntled, and we we were kind of sick of where we were, and then you can't really do that anymore when we've kind of got what we wanted. Like, we were attacking people to prove our point, like, right, put us on a show, show us, let us show you what we can do and show you what we're about. We do that, then we become tag champs. Okay, well, we've got the belts now. We don't really have a reason to just go around attacking people now, because we should, you know, we shouldn't really want to be starting beef with people, because we're the champs now. We've got what we wanted. We proved our point. So, and then when you lose the belts, and that was a very fun match, actually. I really enjoyed my match with Lycos Jim. They were the ones that took the belts from us. That was a fun match as well. But random tangent there, but still. But yeah, so we did what we had to, really, and we set out and did what was planned. And I feel like, yeah, we could have done more, but also I don't think it was too premature, personally.
Oh, that's fine. Of course, yeah, like I said, moved into your singles career. So September 2022, you defeated Martin Kirby and became the High Octane champion. So Martin Kirby, of course, very much a respected wrestler in the UK. But before
Too
then,
underrated person. Like, I'll say this, Martin Kirby, everyone knows how good Kirby is, but also he's a lot better than that as well, if that makes sense. Like, Martin Kirby should be absolutely everywhere. He's the most professional wrestler in the country, honestly. He's the nicest guy ever. One of the best matches I've had personally. You can learn a lot from Martin Kirby. He's too good. And like I said, everyone knows how good he is, but also they should say it more. He is greatly underappreciated, personally.
Well, I was just going to, before I delve further into that, the month before you had a match with Jack Jester. And of course,
Yes.
Scottish Wrestling Podcast, we're going to speak about Scottish wrestling at some
Of
point.
course, of course.
I mean, by hook or by crook, I mean, the episode with Mike Mondo, I think we like mentioned Discovery Wrestling once just to tick a box. So yeah, Jack Jester, that's quite a different opponent than you would usually get in Target. So I think maybe comparative, maybe medallion, possibly just because he's big, broad, powerful. So I was like getting in the ring with a guy like Jack Jester, of course, big reputation, big guy.
Yeah, I absolutely loved it. Like, when I first saw the match announced, because I was never told that I was wrestling him either, I just saw it when it was announced on the Target Facebook, and I was like, oh, Jesus Christ, I'm gonna die. Because I've obviously, like, for a funny story as well, and I never said this to him, but Jack Jester is the first ever wrestler that I remember seeing in person. I would have been about 8 years old. It was just at a random camp, you know, like the holiday parks. I think it might have been a haven or something. I can't remember what it was. Just somewhere in Scotland, and I was about 8 or 9 years old. And honestly, I just remember just sticking my hand out to him for a high five, and he was a heel. Obviously, he just looks me dead in the eye, and I'm like, oh shit, crap, I'm going away now. But yeah, so that was quite a little. It was quite a cool little moment for me, wrestling him for that reason. Obviously, I didn't want to make him feel old
Yeah, I was going
by
to say
saying
maybe not go to maybe after the
that,
match, but not before
yeah.
it.
But oh, I love that match. Honestly, it was really fun. So simple, but some of your best matches are the simplest as well. Less is more, you know. But I feel like we did everything that we had to. The crowd really loved it. Yeah, it was a lot of fun. But like you said, it's a lot different. It's a lot different to, like, say, like a Robbie X or someone, for example.
It's one of those things, I suppose. Same with Kirby, I guess. You find that the veterans that you face, you find out very quickly that less is more. Like if you're facing someone that's new, they'll have all these ideas and go, "Oh, well, we'll do all this and all that," and then you'll get a gesture. He goes, "No, you don't need to. You've got 15 minutes. Let's do some. Let's maybe do one or two, maybe three if we're pushing it. Big moments, and then
Of
everything
course.
else we'll figure out on our way." But yeah, if you came in with like, I don't know, I'm not going to pick off Fulton King, but it's just the first name that's popped up my screen here for Twitter. But he might come in and go, right, we'll do this, 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 and you're kind of the same kind of experience. You go, yeah, we'll do all of that, and then afterwards the crowd's reacted, but then Kirby and Jester come out next, do three things, and they're just as excited. And you
Oh, of
go,
course,
oh, I'm knackered here. And they come out whistling and they even sweating because they've just had a barn burner and they've done nothing at the same time. So all those
Yeah,
kind of
absolutely.
big learning experience. It was the same that I've went backwards in my notes here, because the month before you were against Josh Terry, who's
Yes.
another big opponent, and he's an absolute different animal as
He
well in
is.
comparison to those ones. So We are going backwards here, but what was it like getting the ring with Josh Terry?
Yeah, it's, see, it's funny, we're going through like this time, like the part after breaking up with Spawn, I've had just the best matches I've probably had ever. And obviously I've only had a short career, so that's easy to say, but just I've had a stretch of matches where like I've really enjoyed them, and I feel like each time I'm getting better. And it was the same with Josh, like obviously Josh is underrated as well. Like I feel there's a pattern here as well. Like there's a lot of people that I feel like they don't get enough praise, really. Josh is not human with some of the stuff he does as well. But yeah, I wasn't fully knowing what to expect, like when I was facing him. But once again, just a really other fun match. And I'd wrestle Josh every. I'd wrestle, you know, I'd wrestle him all the time if I could. But he should be. He should be elsewhere, you know what I mean? He should be doing better things, I would say, than wrestling someone like me. He should be off in the big leagues and that, but we'll see. We'll see where he ends up. But yeah.
So we'll go back into the Twitter questions because Fulton King just
Yes.
put one in 33 seconds ago as I record this,
Oh.
and which it was kind of a weird timing because we're speaking about your matches and we actually just
Yes.
spoke about the tag team match, and the two questions he's got in here is favorite match you've had. So we'll start with that one. What's the favorite match you've had so far?
Oh, that's a silly question. I don't know. Oh God.
I'll add the second part while you're thinking that he's put, and why is it when me and Chris battered you?
To be fair, it was a very fun match. However, not it's not that one. Oh God. That is up there actually. That was a really fun match. I was quite proud of what we did. Favorite match. See, this is always a tough one. Maybe Kirby, I would say. Martin Kirby, for the High Octane belt. That was quite a fun one. Obviously, I had my match with Robbie X as well. That's up there. But it was just, the match with Kirby, just everything clicked. And obviously, I won the belt, became champion, of course. You can't forget that. But yeah, that every I just it was so fun. I'd wrestle Kirby every day if I could.
So
I'd, yeah, I'd
alternate,
say.
you go Kirby, Terry, just to mix up a little bit.
Yeah, of course. Yeah, that's it. That's my favorite match, I would say, so far. The match with Martin Kirby.
Excellent. So we've got a question for Sammy Sparks, which we've kind of covered a little bit, so I think I know what your answer is going to be. How did it feel to go from working tag stuff with Spawn to then working back to single stuff? And which do you prefer, single matches or tag matches?
I still prefer singles more, but I did appreciate just how much goes into tag matches, and I did find a love for tag wrestling during my Spawn run. Obviously going from tag to singles, I did prefer it. I felt like I can, I don't know if it's a bit of selfishness, I can kind of show off more of what I'm capable of personally in a singles match. But yeah, obviously, because I was doing the single stuff before Spawn as well, so it was kind of just going back to what I was doing, just with a bit more experience as well. But yeah, it is different, but I do prefer singles, I would say. Obviously, you can tell that from how I've been in the podcast, but
I find
yeah.
also there's also a bit more control in singles as well,
Yes.
because at least then you're only worrying about yourself and your opponent or opponents, whereas if you're a tag team you have to worry about yourself, your partner and your opponents, because if
Yes, yeah.
they your partner fucks up, then you've got to either correct it, and it's just yeah, it seems to be a
Thoughts?
bit more of a scary thing to deal with. Judas Gray's got a question. Don't know if you're familiar with Judas Gray.
Yeah, yes.
I hope you know what DMG stands for, because otherwise I don't want to explain it again. Would you like to become one of my loyal subjects and join DMG?
No, because I have a vague. I remember slightly what it means, and as much as I appreciate the lovely offer, no, not just yet, please.
That been the answer. Not yet. It's like, give me a couple of years and then I don't know.
Yeah, quite a few years, please.
That's fine. Anyone who doesn't know what DMG stands for, just message you just directly. I've explained it. I think I've explained it the last two episodes to people, and it's awkward for me to do it, and I'm not even part of it. It's just a thing now that I've somehow got to explain to other wrestlers, and And that makes me look like the weirdo. Right, okay. So we've got other things coming up. We also November 2022, you had a debut Northside Frontier Wrestling. So I was outside of Target. Was that your first outside of Target experience?
No, so outside of Target, the first promotion I did outside of Target was PCW. They run
Oh, of
their open
course,
ring
yeah.
shows. So they were a lot of fun. It was nice to, it's always nice to get about and just experience different places and see if the crowds are different, or and just getting to wrestle different people as well. Like, obviously it's, I feel very fortunate with Target because obviously Target runs quite regularly. So I always know I'm at least going to have, obviously if I'm doing my job correctly, I'm going to have at least two shows, about two shows a month. So, but with that, you're kind of around the same people. You kind of get used to it a bit. So getting about and experiencing new places and just wrestling different people, it makes you a lot better. Especially, I feel like if you're a wrestler who wants to get about, or get better, you kind of need to venture out different places and get that experience, in my opinion.
Speaking of venturing, on March 5th, you'll be making your Pro 2 debut.
I will
So,
indeed, and I'll be coming the new Scottish Inns promotional champion.
Owen Ozzy Michaels will is Pro 2. So yeah,
I
you'll be
think it's
against Frank Cross for the Scottish Interpromotional
exactly.
Championship. Of course, this title's now it's had quite a few good names that have held the belt. We've had like Stone Malone
Course.
and I've blanked Skiba Lee, Grant McIver, Sam Barber. So it's got quite a good lineage already. So
Of course. And guess
and
who's getting added to it? Owen Ozzy Michaels, baby. Let's go.
we'll clip that Logan Storm. We can clip that and
Oh,
use that. So yeah, that should be fun because I hear a lot of good things about the Pro 2 shows in general. It seems like a really
yeah.
well-run promotion, and yeah, you're making your debut right into the championship picture as well. So
As I should be.
can't be all bad. Last question I've got on Twitter is from again Fulton King. You know he's regular with these questions. He's
Of
put Big Stallion. What match would you show a non-wrestling fan to get them into wrestling?
okay. Ray versus Eddie, Halloween Havoc 97. Just, it's one of my favorite matches, so why not? Just a random one that came to my head, but I feel like it's Ray and Eddie. You can't go wrong with them, can you, really?
No, I mean that, when you said Ray and
So.
Eddie, I was thinking because your age, I thought it might be the year they wrestled at WrestleMania, which was an amazing match as well. So,
Oh, well, there you
yeah,
go.
you can't go wrong with that. So yeah, fair enough. 1997 Halloween Havoc. Actually, don't think I've watched that match all the way through.
Have you not?
No, I don't think I have.
Oh,
I've
man.
like I've seen highlights, and you can't not see highlights of it because whenever these either are mentioned, the highlights of those matches pop up. I can't remember
Of
watching
course.
it all the way through. So.
Oh, damn.
I need to make that a priority. By the time this episode goes out, I will have watched it. So
Course.
nobody on Twitter come at me. I will have seen it by the time this comes out on the Friday. Trust me. But yeah, that's pretty much that's what we've got so far when it comes to your wrestling. We've got our two silly questions that we ask everyone, and then
Course, let's go.
we'll ask about your future aspirations, and then we'll wrap up. But first off, what's your favorite dinosaur?
Oh, right. See, I know you asked this question, and I was like, I don't want to be the boring prick who's just like, oh, T-Rex. Like, oh, right. Okay, so T-Rex is probably my favorite, but let's go with Giganotosaurus, which is kind of like a T-Rex on steroids. Just like a big T-Rex.
That came up from just putting Giga, so that's fine. All right, okay, nice scaly back and all that kind of thing.
Yeah.
Nice,
There we
nice.
go. It's a bit different than just the T-Rex or Velociraptor or Pterodactyl or, you know, the basic ones.
Yeah,
But
I like it. I like finding out new dinosaurs through this. I thought I was a dinosaur guy until I started this and realized I don't know the names of a lot of dinosaurs. Most of them, I've had to Google them now afterwards because some of them, I'm just like, no, you've made that one up. I'm just going to have to go find it. But yeah, Giganotosaurus, about that. Cool. And the other question that we ask is what would win the fight, two sheep or one cow?
Cow. I just feel like, oh, yeah, cow. Like, I know, like, obviously depending on what time of the year, but like sheep have like kind of like that armor of wool, but if they've been shaved, then there's no chances that, you know, I just feel like a cow's a different, isn't a cow like the biggest killer in the UK or something? or some mad stat like that.
Right, I'm gonna
I'm
check that.
sure it is.
Cow biggest killer. I like that that your thought pro. No one's brought that as thought process yet. Depending on the time of year.
I swear, I've seen a stat where it's like it causes the most human deaths in the UK.
Can cows kill humans? That's wow. That's a great thing. Cattle, the greatest human killers of animals in the UK. Sunday National from 2015. Cows
Oh, well,
killed. Yes, there you go. So yeah,
see,
cattle,
this
the
is what I
greatest
mean, and
human
like,
killers.
see, but this is the thing, like, I feel like, yeah, right, I feel like I could take a sheep in a fight, but I don't think I could take a cow.
There's a fun
So this
one.
is my thought process. Like, sheep are getting thrown about by humans all the time. No one's throwing about a cow. So that's my answer. A cow is taking on two sheep.
2015, the Health and Safety Executive found that cows killed 74 people in the UK over the last 15 years by crushing, butting, and trampling victims. Wow.
Damn.
There we go.
Well,
Danger.
see?
The things you learn on this podcast. So, Owen Ozzy Michaels, what's your future plans? Is there anyone that you want to face? Any companies you want to get to, or are you just there along for the ride?
Oh, everyone and everywhere. Honest, I want to wrestle as much as I can, personally. I want to get about as much as I can. I'll wrestle who I can. Obviously, like I said, I'm very much looking forward to getting to Pro 2. I'd love to get about more in Scotland and get to some of the promotions up there because I love wrestling in Scotland. It's a great place, obviously. And it's a Scottish wrestling network, so obviously I'm not going to be seeing some shitty promotion down in the south somewhere. But obviously book me down there if you want as well. But yeah, I'll wrestle, honestly. I love being able to wrestle, so I'm not going to call out any names, but if I'm lucky enough to get about and wrestle anyone, then honestly, that'll make me happy.
You're at a fine age where you've had you've had a handful of opponents, hopefully in comparison to what your career may be. So yeah, just want to just best of luck everyone, and then give it 5 years, and we'll speak again. Hopefully, if I'm doing season 20 of the podcast, and then you might have a bit of a short list, you might have a bucket list at that point. But great, that's been a great chat. Thank you very much for joining me. Where can people find out more about Owen Ozzy Michaels?
Obviously you've got the Twitter at Owen Michaels.
It's with a zero, though, isn't it?
It is a, yes, I've noticed that because Elon Musk changed like that. It looks like an O because that's why I used it, but now he's done a little dash in the zero, so it looks shit. I might
I
change it.
know.
I don't
It's
know.
also a pain in the arse when I try to tag you and stuff.
I know. I know. I'm
I'll
gonna have to sort it.
be
But
honest.
yes, zero when Michaels at Twitter. And then at Owen Michaels on Facebook. I don't use Facebook much. I hate Facebook. I do, but I might have to move to it if Elon Musk keeps ruining Twitter. And then, oh, I think they're the main two places. I'm probably missing one.
I don't think
There's
you
like
use your
three main ones, is there not?
you don't use your Instagram much, do you?
No, I don't know.
No.
So yeah, Twitter's the main place, I would say.
Cool. It's fine. Well, thank you very much for joining me today.
Honestly, thank you very much for having me. Thank you.